Pope Pius XII evokes widely varying reactions. Some people have reviled him, and others praise him to the hilt. And tonight, we want to take a look at what is this controversy and what are the facts. So please stay with us. Thank you very much and welcome. I'm Father Mitch Packwell, and welcome to EWTN Live, our chance to bring you guests from all over the world. Before we get to our guest, I want to mention that today is the feast of Saint Romuald. He was born around 950 or so AD, and he died in 1027. He is famous because that period was the lowest point in the history of the church. That this was a time of a lot of problems and just fact is great corruption. But Saint Romuald, as always happens in the history of the church when there are these times of great difficulty, Saint Romuald was one of those saints who was raised up, and he founded a monastery and an order that became known as the Camaldolese. And these were hermits known for their holiness, and they were able by their own holiness to call other people to that same holiness. And they had a great effect despite the very small numbers, and wanted to pray for all those who are Camaldolese today, still in our own country and around the world. All right, today we have a very special guest who has been with us in the past and is back to talk about one of his favorite subjects. He has many subjects that are important, but this one is one he's studied quite a bit, and it's also related to a special that we are going to be showing tonight after this program. Mr. Rychlak has been very much a student of Pope Pius XII and has written about him and is trying to respond to many of the things negatively said about the Pope. So let's please welcome Mr. Ron Rychlak and his work on Pope Pius XII. Ron.
Thanks, Father.
Welcome.
Happy to be here.
It is great to have you here. And just so folks understand, you are a professor of constitutional law at Ole Miss University, correct?
Well, we call it Ole Miss or the University of Mississippi.
Yes.
But yes, I am. That's right.
Well, affectionately, it's known as Ole Miss.
Known as Ole Miss, right. Mm-hmm.
And in addition to your work in law and all the rest that you do at the university, you've taken up this issue of Pope Pius XII. Why is this so controversial?
Well, if the leader of the Catholic Church had in fact been turned a blind eye to the Holocaust or been attracted to Nazism or liked Hitler or any of those things, then there's a very serious problem with the church.
Sure.
and all of Christianity, frankly.
Sure.
And there are enemies of the church and enemies of Western values who want to spread that message. And it's a false message. And you look at the evidence and you can prove that.
Well, this is why we want to have a lawyer looking at this, because y'all know how to deal with evidence and present a case. Now, Pius XII, of course, didn't start off that way, Eugenio Pacelli. What is some of his early link or connection with the Nazis?
I don't know if I call it a link with the Nazis, but in 1917, World War I is going on. The Pope sent him to Bavaria to be the papal representative in Munich. So he's in Munich as World War I comes to an end. All these disgruntled German soldiers come home, including Adolf Hitler. Mm-hmm. And so there, you know, these two enormous world figures are in this one city in the 1920s. As Hitler is emerging, the future Pope is there as a papal representative watching things happen.
Mm-hmm. So, and that's what I meant by link, that they were right. in Munich, and so folks understand, Munich and Bavaria in general was the, you know, among the most Catholic areas of Germany. And so that's why, you know, such an important papal representative is in Munich.
That's right. And Pacelli sees this develop. And you have to understand the economy after the end of World War I. These soldiers come home, there's no jobs, there's rampant inflation, there's fighting in the streets on a daily basis, and it creates a situation perfect for a guy like Hitler to come to power.
Mm-hmm. And as Hitler did come, because he started riots, he was arrested for a little while, spent some time in jail, and wrote Mein Kampf while he right. was there. What was, you know, Bishop Pacelli doing at the time?
Well, as early as 1921, he's quoted in a newspaper talking about this new radical political movement that's developing, and it's opposite than the communists, but it's very dangerous. In 1923, he writes back to Rome about this Hitler and his followers who are persecuting Jews, persecuting Catholics. He singles out a German bishop who's making a good example by standing up for the Jews. So in 1923, before Hitler's really very big, Pacelli's already telling Rome there's a bad guy that's coming along here. Mm-hmm.
So he recognized a problem early on. And I know that Bishop Pacelli gave quite a number of talks while he was in Munich. And did any of them ever address the rise of the Nazis?
Sure. I mean, the figure that we usually use is we have very complete records of 44 speeches that he gave while he was in Munich. In 40 of those speeches, he condemned anti-Semitism, racialism, nationalism, all the things that were fundamental to Nazism. They weren't known as Nazis yet, as most of these speeches were being given, but he condemned the things that they were standing for.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, this is, by the way, there was also at the same time in Munich, a Jesuit priest, Rupert Meyer, who's now been beatified, also speaking out against the Nazis and the communists. So there were a number of people doing this. But, you know, the point here is that he was not in any way fascinated or attracted to these people.
No, quite the opposite. He saw it as a danger. He saw it as an evil movement. He spoke against all of those things that were so important to this emerging, developing, what would result in Nazism.
Now, there's also an interesting development, a parallel development between Bishop Pacelli and Adolf Hitler in terms of coming into prominence in the 1930s. Tell us a little bit about where Pacelli went
in the
30s.
In 1929, Pacelli was called back to Rome, where he was elevated, made a cardinal, and was named Cardinal Secretary of State in 1930. He never went back to Germany.
Under which pope?
This would have been under Pope Pius XI.
Okay.
And so he's Secretary of State throughout the 1930s. Hitler does not come to power until 1933, but in 1933, he takes power. Well, now Pacelli is representing the Holy See in international issues, and Hitler is in charge of Germany. So now we have sort of the second great coincidence or great intersection between these two lives, mm-hmm. where Pacelli had been on behalf of Pius XI, trying to get negotiations and relations with Germany. Hitler comes to power and says, hey, you've got an offer to have relations with Germany. I want to take that deal. And it causes great consternation. Pacelli wrote letters about it, said it was like we have a pistol pointed to our head. We don't want to be associated with this guy, Hitler, but he's said he wants to take our deal that we've proposed. We've been trying to get with Weimar. Weimar wouldn't do it.
Yeah, so folks understand, The Weimar Republic was the name of the government headed by General von Hindenburg, before Hitler.
Precisely,
right?
Precisely. Right. That's
so
right.
So that's the Weimar Republic, and they wouldn't give us, give the Vatican a concordat.
Right.
Hitler did.
And Hitler and Hitler saw that he would get some benefit from having just the relationship with the Vatican. The Vatican understood that the optics of it weren't going to look good, but on the other hand, it would protect people, and it did in fact protect people, including a number of Jewish people later on in the war. Ultimately, the Holy See did agree to sign a concordat to protect Catholics and anyone holding a Catholic baptismal certificate areas.
See, that's one of the keys. There was a concordat with Hitler.
With Germany. Not with Hitler.
It was with Germany. He was the chancellor at the time.
But, it went on until the 1950s. That's what it's important to say. This was not an agreement with the Nazi regime. It was an agreement with the company, that went on into the 1950s.
Right, because there still was a parliamentary system when Hitler was first chancellor, correct?
Correct.
Yes. So this concordat with Germany included protection of anybody who was Catholic, correct?
Correct.
All right. So like you said, that came into play later. Now, how do things develop into the 30s?
Well, as we go through the 30s, Pope Pius XI is working very closely with Pacelli. It's clear he's tapped him to be his successor, and he cultivates him, sends him around the world at a time when popes had not traveled much. Pacelli traveled a lot. In fact, Pius XI
came here.
He did.
He came to the United States.
Traveled the United States. Pius XI said, Pacelli speaks with my voice. And the voice was very anti-Nazi. The Holy See spoke, it was understood, what the Pope said was understood to condemn Nazism under Pius XI, and by the way, under Pius XII as well. The world at the time understood that the Pope was very opposed to Nazism, Pacelli often was that voice.
Now, one of the events of the later 30s was an encyclical, it's very rare that an encyclical is written in German.
Right.
And this was Mit brennender Sorge. Now, in this, what was the message?
Well, Mit brennender Sorge essentially condemned the foundation of Nazism. It talked about how it's preposterous to try to lock within the confines of one people, the Aryan people, all that is good and great in God's humanity. And like you said, it was written in German. It was distributed in Germany. It was read Palm Sunday. It was read from the pulpit, and then immediately suppressed by the Nazis. Right. They gathered all the copies up, smashed the printing presses, arrested people who had distributed it. Right.
And it had to be snuck into Germany.
It was.
It was smuggled in.
It was published in the United States in Catholic Digest, which was like a Reader's Digest, but Catholic articles. And the title in the United States was To the German People. Everyone understood. We're talking about the Pope is saying what you're doing is wrong. And by the way, right around this time, Pius XI sent Pacelli on a couple of diplomatic trips where Pacelli spoke about the blood cult that was spreading across Germany and Europe at that time and how evil it was. And actually, there are some Nazi political comics that openly mock Pacelli for having spoken so boldly against Nazism.
Now, did Cardinal Pacelli at this stage, did he agree with Mit brennender Sorge, or was he standoffish towards it?
No, he absolutely agreed. He was one of the co-authors of it. Everything comes out under the Pope's name, and the Pope approves everything. And so it's Pope Pius XI's encyclical. But, the early drafts are now accessible in the archives. And you see it's Pacelli and Cardinal Fallhaber from inside of Germany who are working on it, working the drafts. There are drafts that are much more forceful. There are some that are less forceful. They're trying to hit the right tone that's going to be effective and not cause severe retaliation. In fact, they caused a lot of retaliation.
Yes.
But they're struggling to find, what's the right thing to say.
Right. So this gets published and causes, you know, the Nazis never take any criticism, says, oh yeah, maybe we should think about that. No, right, they never had any doubt about themselves.
Right.
They were convinced they were right. They claimed that their racism was based in the scientific work of Charles Darwin in his book, The Descent of Man, which was a very important book in German. It was translated early. So they're using Darwinian, you know, ideas about race and saying, this is science, so we are right.
Yeah, absolutely. They talked about worthless eaters, people who are just drains on our society. It was not originally the Jews. At first it was the handicapped people who were targeted. But you know, that's what they did. They made a scientific argument to try to advance their ideology. In 1937, Hitler came to Rome. This is a fascinating little tidbit.
Yes.
You know, when he's going to come, and Rome had parades, and because Mussolini, they're buddies, you know, and everything's going to be really great. The Pope and Secretary of State Pacelli go to Castel Gandolfo outside of Rome 2 months early. They order that the Vatican be darkened, museums are all closed. You know, if you watch, if I can mention a different network, the History Channel, my wife used to call it NTV, All Nazis All the Time, because I was always watching Nazi programs. But Hitler loved to film himself under the Eiffel Tower, the Arc de Triomphe, wherever he went. There are no films of him in the Vatican because the Vatican went dark. And in fact, the parade they had planned to welcome Hitler, they avoided the whole area of the Vatican because it would have been an embarrassment to Mussolini, the fact that everything was dark, and priests and nuns were ordered not to participate in the festivities.
Right, right. So this, and you know, this was, you know, a slap in the face to Mussolini and Hitler, which neither of them really liked getting, did they?
No, and when you think, I mean, we've got Vatican City in the middle of fascist Italy,
right.
and you've got just 100 miles north of there, you've got Hitler beginning to militarize, and who's the one who makes the most profound statements against what's happening? It's the Pope, right. and his Secretary of State. One of Pius XI's last statements was a famous statement about how it's impossible for a Christian to be anti-Semitic. Spiritually, we're all Semites. Secretary of State Pacelli repeated that. A beautiful essay appeared in the Virginia Quarterly a year later, translated. Jacques Maritain wrote it about what a profound statement this was. It doesn't sound that unusual to our ears today, but in 1938, that was very profound for a pope to say something
like
that. And
so folks understand, Jacques Maritain lived, I believe, in occupied France, Nazi-occupied France. So he knew what a striking kind of statement this was.
And he was married to a Jewish woman.
There you go.
So yes, it was deeply personal to him, and he wrote this beautiful essay, this great tribute, one of the last things that Pius XI ever said just before he passed away.
So there's nothing in Pacelli's history showing any interest, any support, or any, you know, slackerness toward the Nazis. No. Now, and he then becomes Pope when?
Becomes Pope in 1939, just about 6 weeks before the Germans go into Poland.
Right.
And World War II.
Yeah, that
begins.
Was September 1st, 1939. So 6 weeks before that, he's made Pope.
Yeah, but so maybe it's a little more, because it was, I guess, in March he was made Pope.
But the
6 weeks is 6 weeks afterwards, is his first encyclical, Somni Pontificatus, mm-hmm. which, in my book, Hitler, the War, and the Pope, I devote a whole chapter to understanding that encyclical, because that encyclical, he lays out what is his role as Pope, what the role of the Church is, how there is no difference between Christian and Jew, but the Church in Christ is open to all. The headline from the New York Times says, Pope condemns racists, dictators, and treaty violators. I mean, the New York Times recognized this was a direct slap at Germany.
Sure.
At Hitler.
Now, still, you know, you got this, all right? So he's doing well in his anti-Nazi attitude. What did he do during the war? You know, is there, what's going on during the conflict? Because the war starts in 39 and the atrocities begin immediately.
Absolutely. And I think one of the first stories that's usually neglected in this case was that the resistance inside of Germany had plans. A lot of people are familiar with the movie Valkyrie, which was later in the war an attempt to overthrow
Hitler. Right, by the military leaders.
Right. But early on, there were other plans to do that. And the resistance inside of Germany decided they needed somehow to get message to the Allies to say, hey, we're going to try and topple this guy Hitler. And if we do that, we need you guys to know that that's what we're doing and not come out here and just start executing us or something. So they got a lawyer named Joseph Mueller. This, by the way, this is a group Bonhoeffer was associated with.
Yes, that's right.
And they get Mueller to go to Rome. He contacts the Pope and he says, you know, here's what's going on. Can you get this message to the British leaders? And the Pope did that. Didn't work with his associates. He personally did that. We have the records in London. We haven't found records in Rome, but we found the records in London. Moreover, he even warned the British about German troop movements about 10 days before they went into the Low Countries. So, I mean, here you have a Pope early in the war warning
the Allies
about what the Germans are beginning to do. It's a pretty clear violation of neutrality, it seems, but he understood, you know, what was really bad and what needed to be done. As the war went on, particularly when Germany occupied northern Italy, he ran a tremendous underground facility where all the churches, all the seminaries, all the church properties were used to shelter Jews, yes, but also sometimes AWOL German soldiers, Allied soldiers who downed behind enemy lines. Anybody who needed sanctuary turned to the church, and they were sheltered throughout Rome and really throughout occupied Europe.
Yeah. Now, here's the question. You know, a lot of people say he was so quiet. He didn't speak out enough against the execution, extermination of the Jews and the homosexuals and the gypsies. What do you say about that silence?
Well, number one, go back and look at the headlines from the newspapers. People, there's sort of a papal speak, the way popes speak. And newspapers understood that. Their headlines throughout the war, how Pope is opposed to this, Pope opposes that, stands for this, does that. In the Jewish press and the popular press and the Catholic press, no one doubted where the Pope stood or what he said. Now, there is the idea of subsidiarity in Catholic thought, where the Pope understood there were areas where you could push harder. The most outspoken statements of all, I believe, came from the American bishops. We had a free press. There's no risk of retaliation. They have a very strong statement in 1943 that talks directly about what the Nazis are doing to the Jews. Mm-hmm. And I've actually been in Dunwoody Seminary through the papers of a Cardinal Spellman, where Cardinal Spellman is writing back and forth to the Pope, planning this, and then the Pope thanking him later for their collaboration. The Pope understood the message there could go somewhere and could do something and not cause retaliation. Other places, Holland's the great example, where the bishops were very outspoken and led to great retaliation and a lot of people dying.
They excommunicated anybody who was a Nazi or even someone who was Dutch and cooperated with the Reich, the Third Reich. If you just worked for the government, you were excommunicated. What was the reaction of the Nazis?
The reaction there was a Catholic baptismal certificate no longer would protect you. It used to be the most famous one is Edith Stein, right. St. Teresa Benedicta of the Cross, who grew up in a Jewish family. She had a Catholic baptismal certificate. She became a nun.
She became a nun.
So she was not going to be deported when they began rounding people up because she was Catholic. When that happened, the Nazi leadership said, the heck with it, we're going to round them all up, including, in fact, anyone who's Jewish and Catholic's our worst enemy. She gets rounded up. Other Jewish Catholic people get rounded up, sent off, and die at Auschwitz.
Right away.
Yeah.
And they, to make a point, those who had Protestant baptismal certificates were left alone.
They were. That's
they
absolutely
targeted
right.
the Catholics yeah. to show the bishops, you better shut up.
Yeah, but see, that shows how it's not a cookie cutter solution. You can't say this is going to work everywhere. areas where we can push hard, the United States, we're going to push hard. Other areas where we have to be much more subtle. In fact, one of the great examples here is Pius XII wrote a letter and had it smuggled into Poland. The bishop who was left in charge in Poland at the time.
Cardinal Hlund.
Hlund was actually in England. The cardinal, now you threw me off. It begins with S, and I should know this. But he looks at the letter, takes it over, burns it, writes a letter back, and they have this in Rome, where he said, Holy Father, thank you. We'll never forget this great thing. But if I read this, people are going to die. So we're not going to read this one. And so, you know, that's the Pope's information from inside of Poland that says outspokenness is going to get people killed. So what does the Pope do there?
Right.
You know what?
So then you have to make a choice. It seemed that he's made a choice. You don't have to, but he made a choice to go for a prudence that was quiet, but active in saving Jews in Italy and elsewhere.
That's right. I mean, he by the way, it's Sapia. Sapia is was okay.
Sapia.
But he at near the end of his life, the Pope said, you know, if only peace could be had by the crying of peace, no. But you don't just say words and make things happen. He worked very hard. He asked people to pray for peace. He did all kinds of political interventions. He sheltered people. He did what he could. He worked very hard. And the very outcome of the war might have been different if he'd taken a different path. I mean, we don't know.
Right. But I certainly know that I remember hearing a Jewish leader say that the first day the Nazis began rounding up Jews in Rome, a lot died. But once Pius found out this was going on, he ordered all the convents and monasteries and churches to hide Jews, and the greatest percentage of Jewish population saved was the Jewish community of Rome, because Pius hid them in the Vatican in Castel Gandolfo.
That's absolutely correct. There's all kinds of evidence to back that up and show that the Pope had numerous diplomatic interventions to try to save those people. He got some people released, actually, after the initial roundup. But then all major roundups ended at that point. Mm-hmm. There's some fascinating stories, though, of Jewish groups being sheltered. There's a knock at the door, and they switch from their Jewish prayer to singing the Ave Maria, because they have to present themselves as Catholic if the Nazis come in.
Sure. So we're going to show a little clip of this movie that we're going to show after this program. So let's take a look at this. It's a section where Pius XII goes into the bombing of a train station. It's called Pius XII Under the Roman Sky. So please take a look at this.
Right away, and I'll contact General Eisenhower, who will make a formal protest. Your Holiness.
It's not mine.
never happen again, Martini. Never again.
Get an idea that one of the things about, you know, that this movie portrays so well is that, like Pope Francis recently said, what good is a shepherd if he doesn't have the smell of the sheep on him? I mean, Pius XII was out there with his suffering people, and he really spent time during these turmoils with the folks.
I mean, he absolutely did. Here's one of the things that's often overlooked and sometimes falsely depicted, but during the war, during the occupation of Rome, during the war really, he went on wartime rations, the same thing that everyone else had. No hot coffee, very little food. The guy's over 6 feet tall. At the end of the war, he weighs 118 pounds. He stands, when the bombs fall on Rome, and by the way, the bombs, I think the worst bombs were actually American bombs, because the Italians, they were hitting Italian targets. They put the targets near the Vatican. But he stands at the window, and as soon as the bombs stop dropping, he says, get medicine, get blankets. He goes out, gives blessings.
Money.
You know, what people need, he's out there among them, which the movie depicts him doing that, and that's correct.
And he even spent his own personal wealth to save as many Jews as he could, getting them to other countries and such. Thousands of Jews got out of Italy as he paid for it out of his personal money, so he had nothing left. We have to take a break. We're gonna come back in 2 minutes. We wanna get your questions and your comments as well as those of our studio audience. So please stay with us. Thank you very much. First of all, we are so glad to have these folks from different parts of the country, and especially a big group of folks from Cincinnati, but many other places as well. And we'd love to have you come and join us as well. If you can, please contact our pilgrimage department. The number is 205-271-2966, or you can also go to the website EWTN.com, and they'll give you all kind of information about scheduling for the programs, the times of masses, and you also have, you know, they'll give you information about places you can stay and other restaurants and such as that, that you can come to. So we'd love to have you as part of that. And of course, they'll give you information on how to get up to Hantsville as well. Also, you know, this movie about the life of Pius XII is going to be not only broadcast here, but you can also get it from EWTN's religious catalog. And you just have to go to, you can call them at 1-800-854-6316. Or you can go to www.ewtnreligiouscatalog.com. It's called Pope Pius XII Under the Roman Sky. Part one will be tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern Time, and then there'll be an encore on Saturday at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Well, part two will be on June 26th at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, and an encore again Saturday, June 29th at 8 p.m. So keep an eye for it. It's very exciting, very well done. You ready for some questions?
Absolutely.
All right, let's start off. We have a phone caller. Hello, Dr. Alice.
You know, I want to thank you for this outstanding show, which has a very particular interest for me because my husband was a close friend of Pius XII. And so I have information which I would like to share. He met Pius XII when he was, of course, only representative in Germany in 17. And he stayed in Munich from 17 to 22. During this time, they had a very frequent intercourse. Very often he was invited at my husband's home, and they became friends. And, of course, immediately agreed on all crucial questions. Then he left for Berlin in 22, but he remained in contact with Pacelli when he became Secretary of State and then Pope. And the last time that he saw him was in Castel Gandolfo in 1954. Now, at my request, my husband wrote his memoirs, which to my joy will be published by Random House this coming January. And in it, he has long passages about Nazism and Pius XII. And I mean, this is what I would briefly like to share with the audience, because I think it's extremely interesting. Number one, in 1935, when my husband was in Vienna, had abandoned Germany freely because he didn't want to live in the country headed by a criminal, and founded an anti-Nazi, anti-communist magazine in Vienna. He went to Rome in January 35, had a private audience with Pius XII, and in this, you know, he was Secretary of State. And they started to discuss Nazism. I'm quoting from the memoirs. Pacelli said to my husband, between Christianity and Nazism, there's no possibility of reconciliation. It's like fire and water. He also relates in his memoirs that my husband said to Pacelli that he was very disappointed about what he called the great prudence of Bursian bishops in Fulda in 33, when they did not officially condemn racism, except two of them. Now, Pacelli answered, dear professor, I totally agree with you, but the church cannot command martyrdom. The last time that he saw him was in 54, as I said, but they remained in contact their whole life long. When Hawkwood published his disgusting play, The Deputy, my husband was absolutely beside himself. He said, it's a pack of lies. How can a man dare say things which are so absolutely monstrously false? We had long discussions about that, and I just want to share with you what my husband said. Both my husband and Pacelli were convinced that Nazism could not last long. And the theory was the following. Racism is something so incredibly stupid that it has no chance of survival. It was kept up by Hitler, who was a madman, but simultaneously charismatic, and could simply inflame. And he said, you know, just to decide that only the blonde beast is the superior person, and all the others are inferior. This could not conquer the world because most of us, including most of the audience tonight, are not blonde beasts. And if you're told that you're inferior because you're not a blonde beast, then obviously you're not going to endorse him. Communism was infinitely more intelligent. Hitler and Stalin were twins in evil. And when my husband was in France in 39, and they had a pact of non-aggression. My husband went public and said, this is the hour of truth. people should realize, you know, that Nazism and communism are one and the same, because some people became communists because they had Nazis and vice versa. He said to me communism was infinitely more clever, because the theory was that some people are treated unjustly, you know, the lower class and the masses and the hoi polloi and the proletariat. And of course you have it all over the world, because injustice is something shockingly sharing. This is why Stalin remained in power for 41 years. Hitler was doomed to be lost. And therefore, from the very beginning, the communists knew that Pacelli was so keen that he knew that communism was going to endure, whereas Nazism was going to be. And therefore they hated him, and then they actually paid someone who was a leftist as far as communism as one go, and wrote this shameful play, which my husband immediately rebutted. Well, of course, a lot more is going to come when his memoirs are published, but this is something that I wanted to share with you.
Thank you very much. As a matter of fact, you know, Ron, you have also heard some of the same things that the communists were very much afraid of Pius XII and the church. And what's the link between them and Hochhut? See, so folks understand, Hochhut is the author of a play called The Deputy, which accused Pius XII of cooperating with the Nazis, written 5 years after his death. So what's that link?
Hochhut is known as the author of The Deputy, but a guy I'm working with now, the former head of the Romanian equivalent of the CIA, in essence, sort of head of their spy stuff, revealed in 2007, and I've got a chapter in Hitler, the War and the Pope, about how the Kremlin, the Soviet bloc intelligence office, actually promoted this idea of Pius XII as being Hitler's Pope. They actually got control of that play, shaped it, produced it, put it in a theater building, a theater house that they established to do propaganda plays, got a guy who had all his life done work for the Communist Party. They really cultivated this idea in the 1960s. I mean, at the end of the war, Pius XII was hailed as a great hero. At the time of his death, it was a great hero. It was 1963 when this play comes out, and then throughout the 1960s, as that is being developed, this idea of the bad Pius XII, and it was Soviet disinformation that was behind that.
Because certainly the State of Israel and Golda Meir and many other leaders, you know, strongly commended Pius XII, and Jewish experts in the Shoah, the term, the Hebrew word for that destruction of the Jews, those experts also commend him for his work.
Virtually every major Jewish group from around the world at the time of his death sent notes of tribute and thanks and all kinds of stuff. I mean, something happened in 1963, 1964, when this play came out, and it was not an organic thing of an unknown playwright who'd never published anything on his own before, writing a play that suddenly catches fire and changes the world. It was an enormous machinery that was behind that, trying to discredit the Catholic Church by discrediting the Pope and ultimately going all the way to Christianity and Western values themselves.
Sure. We have a question here from a studio audience. Sir, where are you from?
Cincinnati.
Good to have you here. What's your name?
Joe Martino.
No, I mean, what's your question? Sorry.
It's been said that Hitler had actual plans to go into the Vatican and kidnap the Pope, and did the Pope have contingency plans to deal with this?
Yes, he did. Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Yeah, yes, he did have contingency plans. There actually was a meeting of the Curia to discuss what would happen in the event that he was captured or he was killed. I've seen drafts of the minutes last time I was in Rome. Where they called together. And basically, his idea was they were not going to take him alive. If they did take him alive, he was stepping down as Pope. He wasn't going to be Pope anymore. He did not want the Pope to be held prisoner. So if he was taken away, he was no longer to be pope.
Right. He signed a resignation statement that was to be made known. And the Nazis also had plans to kill the cardinals to make sure they could not elect another pope in the absence of Pius.
In recent years, they in fact have found plans to rebuild Vatican City inside of Berlin. Hitler actually had his architect draw up plans to rebuild a bigger and better Vatican City for Germany.
Yeah, but that would be interesting. Young man, where are you from?
Cincinnati.
Good to have you here, and good to have you back, in fact.
Yeah.
What is your question?
I was just wondering if the Jews had any hope of what was going to happen to them under the reign of Pope Pius XII.
Well, I think Jewish people understood very bad things were happening. I mean, you can go back. That was an issue I looked at early in my research. You know, did they know what was happening? And there were a lot of books, a lot of articles that were written that indicated that at least the leadership knew that they were facing very bad things. And the best thing was to keep a low profile, to hide, to perhaps be able to pass yourself off as a Christian by getting a baptismal certificate. Things like that, and there were enormous efforts to do that, to provide false identification to help Jewish people avoid persecution.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's one of the problems is, I've seen statements from Jews living there that said, well, they can't kill all of us. And the concept, like one had said, there were a million of us Jews in Germany, they can't kill all of us. That just seemed so outrageous at the time. But they just didn't understand the organization skills of evil.
You know, I think not just Jews, but I think Americans, I think, you know, even in the Vatican, it's hard to imagine the level of evil there. And so you even know, even if they say it, do you believe Mein Kampf? Mein Kampf was published. Do you believe it? A lot of people read it as, well, it's hyperbole, and that's not going to happen.
Right. But once he got power, he tried to make it happen.
Exactly.
Yeah. I have another question from our studio audience. Ma'am, where are you from?
I am from Cincinnati. I'm Jane Elfers. I'm also interested in your book and in the issue of Pope Pius XII. I wonder if you see similarities today in what's happening with the culture of life and the Fortnight for Freedom that the church is trying to put forth to defend, and what you see the church's role maybe being in defending, especially the issue of abortion, which we seem to be totally being shut out on, and it is a great struggle in our culture.
Boy, you know, you go to the hard question there. I think we have to learn from history, and if we see churches stripped of the power, if we see Christians silenced, if we see people, you know, not permitted to stand up for things that are right, whether it's minorities, whether it's unborn babies, whatever, it's a very dangerous situation. And I do believe that the rights of Catholics, the rights of Christians, are deeply being tested today. And God bless you and EWTN and folks who stand up and try to prop us up for those kind of things, but it's a hard battle.
You see, one of the things that, I don't know how well you remember the 60s, I don't know how old you were then, but I certainly recall the civil rights movement that was to make sure people of color had the rights to vote, to live where they wanted, to get jobs and do it. And that was a tremendous struggle. But the concern I have today is that we need to see we're in another civil rights struggle. You know, we think civil rights only is race, but the civil rights for the Bill of Rights are First Amendment rights to freedom of speech, are certainly, under duress, under, some laws want to call disagreement with official policies in some areas about abortion, same-sex marriage, and other things as hate speech. You know, Secretary Napolitano had come up with early on with a statement warning Homeland Security about pro-life groups. The National Guard in Pennsylvania had a slideshow, or what, they don't call them slideshows anymore, you know, PowerPoint. That's how old I am. A PowerPoint presentation, and one part of it was, you know, identifying the Catholic Church, and I think some other churches, as problems for the National Guard. And you say, wait a minute, the new civil rights issues are going to be First Amendment rights to freedom of religion and speech, and then also Fourth Amendment rights for the search, you know, and acquisition of knowledge by personal knowledge by the government. We have to deal with these things.
Now, absolutely. I teach constitutional law, and so many of the current cases I deal with are, in fact, church people speaking out and being silenced and being told you can't say that, being sanctioned for saying that.
Yes.
Or folks who you say something and you offend somebody and suddenly it's a crime. This is America. We're supposed to have the right to speak freely. And if I say something stupid, you have a right to call me stupid, but not to have me locked up.
Right.
But we see this emerging in the United States. We also see it emerging at a global level.
Yes.
You know, a few years ago, I was part of an American delegation in Paris talking about free speech on the internet. And there were folks trying to give government control over what could be said on the internet. When the Russian delegate got up to speak, he said, you know, the people who really are hateful, we need to stop, are the Hare Krishnas and the Jehovah's Witnesses. Really? I mean, I'm Catholic, so that's not my faith. But all of the hate in the world, and you're going to start signaling out those people? Catholics are going to be next.
Yes.
If you give the government control to be ability to control what we say, they're going to do it. They're going to misuse it.
And what folks don't understand, I'll just make a little last point here, is today there are more people who are enslaved around the world than there were in 1860. And the growth of sex slavery in the sex trade has gotten out of control. And you know, these are serious issues of civil rights that have to be addressed. We have one more question here from our studio audience. Sir, where are you from?
Cincinnati, Ohio. My name is Robert Kors.
Your question?
My question is, do you think the Germans who were ordered by the Nazis to kill the Jews should go to hell?
Do we think that the people who did the executions should go to hell? You want to make a comment on that?
Well, my only comment would be when Stalin was told about the Pope's opposition, he said, how many divisions does the Pope have? And then Pius apparently said, tell my brother Joseph, he'll meet my divisions in heaven. And I always think, if he thinks Stalin can get to heaven, I've got a chance.
Yeah. I think, you know, one of the things that, in terms of that man's question, we have to take very seriously is precisely in this. Our Lord Jesus Christ ordered us not to judge. We can judge. The behavior they did was abominable. It was one of the greatest evils in history. For me or anybody in the church to judge the fate of their souls is impossible. I don't judge that. What I can say, this is hellish behavior. And just like other hellish behavior. But I don't know anybody is going to hell or not. It's not, that's up to our God, our Lord, to do the judgment. It is for us to say the evil behavior must stop. And to call the evil behavior evil, which all of that racism and anti-Semitism was unconditionally evil. And then leave it up to God to judge the souls. But one of the things I can't leave it up to God, but up to the producer, is say that the end of the show has come. Thank you for being with us. appreciate your background. And let me give you all a blessing. May Almighty God bless you and keep you and cause His face to shine upon you and lead you in all your ways by His peace. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And, you know, we can bring you guests like Ron and Dr. von Hildebrand, who's been here before, and so many others, because this network is brought to you by you. And this movie on Pius XII, we can bring to you because you bring it to you. So please keep us in between your gas bill, your electric bill, and your cable bill, so that we can pay our bills, especially during the summer months. Thank you.